Hello, everyone. Those that have joined us are waiting for everyone else to finish trickling in, and we'll start in just a second. All right. Thank you for joining us for Random Review today. My name is Mike Hansen, and I'm a reference librarian at the Corvallis-Benton County Public Library, as well as co-coordinator of Random Review with my fellow librarian, Bonnie Brzowski. Today for Random Review, Dr. Russell Yamada will review Facing the Mountain, a true story of Japanese American heroes in World War II by Daniel James Brown. If you missed any of the previous reviews, you can find them on the Random Review webpage on the library's website. On this webpage, you can also sign up for next month's review where Dali Chow will review Last Boat Out of Shanghai, The Epic Story of the Chinese Who Fled Mao's Revolution by Helen Zia. Before we start today's review, I'd like to acknowledge the Friends of the Corvallis-Benton County Public Library, who are co-sponsors of the Random Review series and have been instrumental in running Random Review for the past 30 years. They make programs like this and many other programs possible. Thank you, friends, for all you do. A reminder about today's program that we will have time for questions at the end, so please submit your questions in the Q&A box on your screen throughout, and we will save them till the end. We'll do our best to answer all questions that we can. And now I'd like to tell you a little bit more about today's reviewer, Dr. Russell Yamada. Russell Yamada is a third generation Japanese Oregonian from Newburgh, Oregon, who came to Oregon State University in 1964 as a pre-dental student. After finishing dental school at the University of British Columbia and postgraduate training at Tufts University School of Dentistry, he established the first endodontic root, which is root canal, practice in Corvallis in 1981. Born in 1946 as a child of World War II, he attributes much of what he has accomplished in life to the battles for justice and dignity his family fought for during and after World War II. Four uncles and his father served in the US Army while their families were incarcerated in a labor camp in Nissa, Oregon. His uncle, Kaz Fuji, served in the 442nd Combat Unit, which is the unit that Daniel James Brown focuses on in this book. It's the most highly decorated regiment in US military history and composed almost entirely of second generation Japanese Americans in World War II. Two of the Yamada's family friends, brothers Max and Earl Hosoda, died in combat while serving with the 442nd. Their sacrifice and their family's resilience paved the way for succeeding generations of Japanese Americans in this country. Like many Japanese Americans, Russell has a strong personal connection to the stories in Facing the Mountain. Today, he would like to share his impressions of Mr. Brown's book, and I can't think of a better person to do so. Russell, thank you for joining us.
Hi, Michael. Thank you very much to you and to Connie Georgiou for initially inviting me. And I'd like to thank all of you on Zoom for coming in here and attending this meeting today. I know that I can't see you, but I can feel your presence. I feel your energy. But if you're laughing or if you're crying, I might be able to feel that as well. I first heard about these amazing stories in the book Facing the Mountain a year ago on a broadcast from Oregon Public Broadcasting when they were doing an interview with the author Daniel James Brown. A few months after, that's when Connie Georgiou, who was actually one of my past root canal patients, asked if I would consider reviewing the book about the 442nd. Now, I never imagined that a root canal would lead to this. So today, I am very honored to review Mr. Brown's stories and share a few of my own. Now, these stories are about real men, real people who faced many mountains, both in Italy and France, to overcome German positions, and their families who faced many mountains on the home front. I first became aware of the 442nd when I was a kid. We would visit my grandfather's grave in Emmett, Idaho. He died in the 1920 influenza epidemic. Now, next to my grandfather's grave was a row of grave markers for one family, the Hosodas. I remember asking my dad what these were about. Actually, there were two graves for two infants that died in childhood, and two graves for one, Sergeant Max Hosoda, and a Private Earl Hosoda. My dad told me that they were both men who died in the U.S. Army during World War II, and they were with the 442nd. That's how I learned about that unit as a boy. I also have learned recently a little bit about Daniel James Brown. Daniel took an interesting path before writing Facing the Mountain. In high school, he suffered panic attacks like many of us could. From this, he actually dropped out of high school, but he finished via correspondence. He then went to Diablo Junior College, did a bachelor's at Cal Berkeley, a master's at UCLA. He ended up teaching writing at San Jose State and Stanford. And then by chance, he ended up working for Microsoft in Seattle for 12 years. At Microsoft, he did 12 years and he did something back at that time where he worked on editing the user's manuals for Windows. But I guess he wanted to try something different and see if he can expand a little bit more on the creativity that the user manuals did not provide for him. So his first book was called Under the Flaming Sky. It was about a Minnesota wildfire in 1894, which involved his great-grandparents who escaped the fire. Next, he wrote a book about the Donner Party called The Indifferent Stars Above. Then finally, he wrote a book before the Facing the Mountain called The Boys in the Boat about the 1936 University of Washington crew team that went to the Berlin Olympics. Daniel Brown starts his book with the very interesting event in history called the attack on Pearl Harbor. For any American who was alive on that day, Pearl Harbor was arguably the most dramatic day in their lives. Now, I remember when President Kennedy was assassinated, and I remember 9/11, but the 420,000 Americans who died on that day, or died in World War II, and the effects that that day had after far exceeded any other event. It was a day that many Japanese American students dreaded going to school, myself included. When I was growing up in Newburgh High School, on Pearl Harbor Day, I always felt that I had to slide down really low into my chair and kind of hide. And then one day, my math instructor, as you see here, Tom Poulton, came over to my desk and he interrupted class for a moment. He said, told me that he was a student at the University of Utah on the day after Pearl Harbor, sitting in an 8 a.m. class waiting for the instructor to come in. Now, the instructor was a professor of math, but he was a Japanese American. After 10 minutes, they wondered if he would even show up at all. Finally, he walked in, stood at the podium, raised his right hand and said, "I swear to God, I'm Irish." Now, Mr. Poulton let out a big laugh, and then we got back to math class as usual. But just by him doing that, I remember that after 60 years, and I remember that, and I still get a chuckle out of what Mr. Poulton did on that day for me. In the attack on Pearl Harbor, 2,400 U.S. servicemen died, but I only recently learned that 71 civilians died as well. Of those 71 civilians, 34 were Japanese Americans. This changed my whole outlook on Pearl Harbor, that we were victims as well. On the first page of his book, Facing the Mountain, Mr. Brown describes an idyllic Sunday morning for one of his characters, Katz Miho. He was a very likable student at the University of Hawaii, and a lot of the girls thought that he looked like Cary Grant. He was busy studying for finals, getting ready to hear beautiful music at his church that morning, and also preparing to go home to Maui for Christmas break. What could be more perfect than that type of setting for a young student? But in a few moments, right after that, Japan would attack Pearl Harbor, and everything would change in an instant. For Japanese Americans, our image became so bad that not even a top-notch PR company could help us out. And you know, you're really in trouble when only Quakers and Methodists are supporting you. We needed a hero. We needed a role model like Joe DiMaggio was for Italian Americans. Now, do you realize that Joe DiMaggio's parents were actually considered enemy aliens because they were from Italy? But because he was a very famous baseball star, that image carried through that helped Italian Americans overcome the effects of World War II. But you know, we didn't have that. In Facing the Mountain, Daniel Brown followed the lives of four ordinary Japanese Americans and showed extraordinary courage that they displayed to become Americans. He discovered that Japanese Americans had heroes that were unknown until Facing the Mountain brought them to life. Being such a prominent author like Mr. Brown brings tremendous amount of credibility to these Japanese American stories, particularly when his previous book, The Boys in the Boat, became a number one bestseller on the New York Times bestseller list. Approximately 18,000 Japanese American Niseis, that means the second generation, served in the 442nd throughout the war. You can ask many of your Japanese American friends if they had relatives or family friends who served in the 442nd, and I'll bet there's a good chance that they'll say yes. Every Japanese American family has captivating stories to tell about their experience. After studying several oral histories taken by Densho, which is a Japanese American historical organization in Seattle, Mr. Brown finally selected four individuals: Gordon Hirabayashi, Katz Miho, Rudy Tokiwa, and Fred Shiosaki. Their stories represent a broad cross-section of the Japanese American experience during World War II. For most of us, they could easily be a father, an uncle, a brother, or a family friend. And what their families experienced could easily be what our families experienced. This is a picture of Katz Miho and his brothers. In this map that you'll see, the different people that I mentioned came from different areas in the country and from different circumstances in their lives. Not all Japanese Americans were interned. If you lived in Hawaii, you were not interned unless you were a prominent person or a community leader. If your family lived on the West Coast in the pink zone, you were gone. Gordon Hirabayashi was from Seattle, and his family was sent to Tule Lake. Rudy Tokiwa was from Salinas, California, and his family was sent to Poston, Arizona. Fred Shiosaki was from Spokane, Washington, inland from the evacuation zone, and his family was not interned at all. My mom's family came from Troutdale, Oregon, which is near Portland, and they were sent out to a labor camp in Nyssa, Oregon, close to the Idaho border. My dad's family was from Nampa, Idaho, and not interned at all. Now, since an internment phase actually affected all of the major population centers of Los Angeles and San Francisco, Seattle, and Portland, the majority of Japanese Americans were imprisoned. Japanese Americans in Hawaii, however, comprised a majority of 157,000 of the state's 423,000 people. They were not interned, but they were held under very strict curfew. The first story that I'd like to let Mr. Brown features is a story about Gordon Hirabayashi, who was not in the 442nd at all. Gordon was a Quaker. He was a peace activist and became famous for resisting President Roosevelt's evacuation orders. Instead of going to an internment camp, he was first sent to a federal prison near Tucson called the Catalina Federal Honor Camp. Now that almost sounds like a Boy Scout camp to me, but it wasn't. The government didn't have the resources to send him there, so he actually, on his own, volunteered to hitchhike from Spokane to Tucson. You can imagine a driver picking him up and saying, "Oh, yeah, well, where can I take you?" And Gordon saying, "Well, I'm on my way to federal prison." Gordon returned to the University of Washington after the war and eventually finished with a PhD in sociology. In 1959, he joined the faculty of the University of Alberta in Edmonton and became the chairman of the sociology department at the peak of his career. After retiring from teaching, he continued to speak out on the defense of civil rights for the rest of his life. And on May 12th, 2012, President Obama honored him with the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the nation's highest civilian honor. He may not have been on the front lines with the 442nd, but he exhibited another type of courage and commitment. I actually met Gordon at a speech he was giving in Portland. I met him in the men's room at the Multnomah Athletic Club. Had a very nice time and a very nice conversation briefly with him. But what I didn't know about him, and I learned from the book, was he actually married a woman named Esther Schmo, who was a daughter of Floyd Schmo. Some of you may know about Floyd. He was a prominent Quaker peace activist. An interracial marriage is pretty common now, but it was quite rare in 1944. It was legal in Washington, but in Oregon, it wasn't. Oregon still had an anti-miscegenation law until 1951. Now, I already spoke a little bit about Katsumiho, who grew up in Maui, and he was attending the University of Hawaii the morning of Pearl Harbor. He was a member of ROTC at the University of Hawaii, and he automatically became a member of the Hawaiian Territorial Guard that patrolled the Honolulu waterfront the night of Pearl Harbor. The next day, all the Japanese American members of the Guard were discharged. However, a year later, President Roosevelt opened up service for the Japanese American group. Hawaiian recruiters recall that Nisei volunteers had 10,000 people that showed up on the very first day. They were very patriotic in the islands. Both Katz and his brother, Katsuaki, volunteered. One thing I've got to make a little comment on, a lot of these Japanese names like Katz were taken, or actually Japanese Americans made interesting nicknames from names like Katz, which was Katsugo, or Kaz, which is Kazuko. I have another uncle, Manabu, which turned out to be Nabi. And I also happen to have an aunt whose name was Susie, but she picked up the name of the famous film star, well, maybe not too famous, called Jinx Falkenberg, and she was called Jinx. During training in Alabama, Katz's brother, Katsuaki, became one of the first in the 442nd to die in a truck accident. Katz went on to serve the entire war in an artillery unit. After the war, he had a very difficult adjustment period, but eventually returned to the University of Hawaii on the GI Bill. And then on to George Washington University in Washington, D.C. for a law degree. He had a good friend that became quite famous, another colleague in the 442nd, Senator Daniel Inouye, who also went to George Washington University for a law degree. Katz returned to Hawaii, became involved in local politics, and was instrumental in helping Hawaii gain statehood in 1959. The next story that Daniel Brown tells is that of Rudy Tokiwa, who grew up in Salinas, California, on a farm. Daniel tells about an incident after football practice at Salinas High School. Now, Salinas High was the school where John Steinbeck attended as well. Rudy and his brother Duke was the star quarterback on the football team, were accosted by half a dozen boys from Oklahoma. One of them said, "Them dirty Japs, let's beat the manure out of them." Rudy and Duke cocked their fists, got ready to have a go at these Oklahoma boys, when a voice behind them said, "All right, you Tokiwa brothers, step aside. We'll handle this." It was a bunch of their teammates from the football team who ran the Oklahomans off. From an early age, Rudy was a tough kid who knew how to use his fists if he had to. Many Nisei had judo training as well. He was a good athlete. And with that came many good white friends, especially their neighbors, Ed and Henry Posey, who were orphaned while in high school. The Tokiwa family helped them convert their dairy farm into a productive vegetable farm. Within a few months, when the Tokiwa family was evacuated to an internment camp in Poston, Arizona, Ed and Henry stored their farm equipment and car and actually took in their family dog. Poston was a desolate camp located on the Colorado River Indian Reservation, which was home to the Mojave and Shemehueve people. The temperatures often registered above 110 degrees, and you could not imagine a more godforsaken place. But in an instant, Poston became the third largest city in Arizona with a population of 18,000 people. They tried to create some sense of normalcy. Churches and schools were started. Police and fire departments were organized. Beauty and barbershops opened, as well as a camp newspaper. Rudy attended high school and worked in the camp kitchen. He also had time for all the sports and surprised himself by taking jitterbug lessons. Dancing to big band music was a big thing for Japanese Americans in the camps. After initially excluding Japanese Americans from service, President Roosevelt came forth and said, "Every American should be allowed to serve in this country." Rudy pondered the question, "Why should I put my life on the line for a country that locks us up in this bleak concentration camp and treats us as second-class citizens?" His father, Jisuke, proudly served in the U.S. Army during World War I. This instilled in Rudy the need to fight and earn the respect as an American who served. That's quite a lot for a 17-year-old high school kid to digest, but he did, and he enlisted soon after high school. As a trainee at As a trainee at Fort Shelby in Mississippi, Rudy gained a reputation for being in the middle of a fight. In battle, his commanding officers depended on him to deliver battlefield commands as a runner. Very dangerous duty. In Italy, Rudy single-handedly captured four German officers for strategic interrogation. How confusing for the Germans. I can hear them saying, "Scheiße, was ist das?" Anyway, Rudy was awarded the Purple Heart and Bronze Star for bravery, but had lifelong injuries. His sister Fumo said, "He came home a changed person." After the war, Rudy lobbied for passage of the Civil Liberties Act of 1988. This authorized President Reagan to offer a formal apology for the incarceration of Japanese Americans. Rudy continued to speak out about his experiences with the 442nd right up to his death in 2004. My next person that Mr. Brown speaks about is Fred Shiosaki. Fred tried to enlist right after Pearl Harbor, but Japanese Americans weren't taken right at that time. So he ended up enlisting a year later. During the year that he was not taken, he spent the time at Gonzaga University. Fred and Rudy were both in a company called K Company that waged a five-day battle to help save a stranded battalion of Texans. Of the original 186 men in K Company, only 17 survived to rescue 211 Texans. In battle, Rudy said it was kill or be killed, which tested his Christian beliefs. During the battle, he came upon a young teenage German soldier on the ground in a fetal position, uncontrollably whimpering for his mama. He leveled his rifle, started to squeeze the trigger, but in a moment, he thought to himself, "He looks so much like my younger brother." He pulled the gun back and said, "You are one lucky son of a gun today." Fred's family was from Spokane in eastern Washington, and as I indicated, were not interned. They carried on with a laundry business, which they had started in 1915. After the war, Fred continued his education at Gonzaga University and finished with a chemistry degree in 1949. He went on to work with Spokane's Air Quality Control Bureau and eventually with the Washington State Department of Fisheries. Fred came home with a Purple Heart and a Bronze Star, plus nightmares that haunted him for years. Fortunately, Fred met a young woman named Lily Nakai. Lily was a tremendous young woman with a past. She was a valedictorian of her high school. They married in 1950, had a wonderful family. Fred died recently in 2021 at the age of 96 and was frequently interviewed by Daniel Brown for this book. Now, Rudy, Katz, Fred, and Gordon are now gone. Their stories will have to live on in this book. At my age, I feel that I've become more acutely aware of the need to pass these 442nd stories on. So in a moment, I would like to continue, but before that, I'm going to take a sip of tea. As Michael said in the introduction, my uncle, my mom's brother, Taz Fuji, grew up on a farm like Rudy Tokiwa, but in Troutdale, Oregon. He was drafted into the Army 6 months before Pearl Harbor and was stationed in San Antonio when the war started. When the 442nd was formed, he was one of the first to join. With his knowledge of farm equipment, he became involved in maintaining motorized vehicles and ended up actually driving troop and munitions trucks. When his truck struck a landmine, he suffered a severe concussion, but he survived. About his time in the Vosges Mountains, which is here circled in the green area of eastern France, Kaz wrote, "I developed many good friendships. Abe Fuji was our squad leader, and Takeo Yamamoto was a young kid from Honolulu. We're both machine gunned on the very first day we arrived in France, October 16, 1944. After 34 days, only 7 of our squad made it out. After the war, Kaz came home to Troutdale by bus from Portland. Fortunately, they had neighbors, the Cunningham family, who looked after their farm, so they had a home to come to, which many did not. Kaz was featured on the Oregon Public Broadcasting program called Oregonians in World War II. And in that program, he said, "That war never left me." For us kids, I recall Kaz having extremely colorful four-letter language that took our vocabularies to another level. Kaz went on to become a major farmer in the Troutdale area, with his favorites being strawberries and raspberries. Reynolds High School now sits on some of the property that he once farmed. In later years, he put great effort into raising money for the World War II Veterans Memorial in Washington, D.C. And he also loved going to 442 reunions and see many of his buddies. I think that was kind of group therapy for him. My grandmother and a very good friend of hers, Itono Hosoda, came to Emmett, Idaho as picture brides in 1913 from Hiroshima. At the age of 19, they came from quite a sophisticated city to marry men they had never met before. The Hosodas had a laundry, as shown here, and my grandmother and grandfather had a diner. They would both later go into farming. They were both early Christians, and maybe even so in the Hiroshima days. And I remember that they both loved to talk and laugh when they got together. My grandmother's son, my father, Roy Yamada, enlisted in the Army a month after Pearl Harbor. He didn't join the 442nd, but was sent to a Pacific island, Tinian, where the atomic bomb was launched. That's a story for a completely different time. Itono, however, had 3 sons that served in the 442nd. Sergeant Max Hosoda was a 1938 graduate of the University of Idaho in horticulture and died on October 18th, 1944, liberating the city of Brières. Max's younger brother joined the 442nd later in the war. Earl Hosoda was a 3-sport star for Emmett High School and died in Pisa, north of Pisa, on April the 5th, 1945, a month before the war ended. Only one son, George, survived the war. Unfortunately, the story for Max and Earl ended way too early. Japanese Americans in Idaho were not interned, but were subject to the sentiment of that time. Early in the war, the Methodist Church in Emmett asked Mrs. Hosoda to leave the congregation. But after she became a double Gold Star mother, she became quite a celebrity in Emmett and even throughout Idaho. The church asked her back. She lived in Emmett for the rest of her life and died at the age of 96. I would like to thank Daniel Brown for writing this book. This is actually a cover of the paperback version. for writing this book and telling the heroic stories of these four young men and their families to the American public. Not often does a book like this come along that reveals such a personal way what Japanese Americans experienced during World War II and what they've accomplished since. One has to realize that these men were very young, 19 to 20 years old, and their siblings were also young adults or high school or grade school students with 50 to 60 year old parents all trying to make the best of life in camps. Brown described the decisions these very young people had to make to carry on not only in battle, but to hold families together on the home front. They faced the mountain little by little, step by step. They pieced their lives together and became respectable American citizens and contribute to this country in many ways. Some of you may have remembered the movie Karate Kid. That's from 1984. The main character was Mr. Miyagi, and he was depicted as a 442nd veteran in this story. He was a karate master, and this story still resonates in pop culture today after 40 years. Pat Morita played Mr. Miyagi and received an Oscar nomination for his role. Now Karate Kid has become Cobra Kai, which has given a new life to this story. I hope Facing the Mountain is still an important read 40 years from now and remains in the public eye to inform Americans about the 442nd. Unlike the Karate Kid, Facing the Mountain is about real men and their families who fought to represent the nation. I would say if you haven't read it, please get a copy. And at that point, I'd like to finish the talk and we will go into some questions in a moment. This is a little strange for me to sit here. I actually feel like I'm just talking to myself. So glad to know that all of you are out there. One thing that I wanted to say is that Pat Morita, before he was an actor, he was actually a comedian. And I wanted to tell you that many of the men in the 442nd that I knew loved, they had a great sense of humor. They liked to drink a lot as well. But Pat Morita, when he was filming the Karate Kid, actually and promoting this over in Okinawa. Had a chance where he was able to speak to a group of people, and he found out that they were having an event called the Samurai Sword Contest. He ended up being told that there were three people that wanted to meet him, and these were the three top winners of the contest. So he really wanted to see what was going on with this. So he went over and actually met the three top people. The third person, he said, "What did you do to take third place in the contest?" Anyhow, the third place finisher says, "See, please observe, fly on wall. Please, look, he blows. Fly goes up. He takes sword, swings, holds out hand. Two equal pieces of fly end up in his hand." Pat says, "My gosh, that is an amazing task that you did." So he goes to the second place finisher and he says, "What can you do to top that?" The second place finisher says, "Please observe, fly on wall. He blows, fly goes up. He swings one, twice, pulls out hand. There lands four equal pieces of the fly." Pat is going, "My gosh, that's amazing. You've topped the other guy." Then he goes to the first place finisher and he says, "What can you do to top that?" First place finisher says, "Please observe. He blows. Fly goes up. He takes a quick jab with the sword. Fly makes two circles and goes off. Pat says, well, it doesn't really appear that you've done anything, and the fly, it looks like he's okay. The first place finisher says, yes, but he will never have children. Anyhow, I just had to get that in. We can probably have a little bit of time for some questions. And Michael, can I bring you in for a minute, or while I take a drink of tea?
Sure, I am here. So if anyone has questions, please submit them in the Q&A box, and we will relay the questions to Russell here. Thank you, Russell, for your talk.
Well, one other thing I want to add briefly is that the 442nd is somewhat known in this country. I had a chance with my wife to visit in Germany, and on our way to Germany, we had a chance to stop by in the city that a lot of these men fought in. It's called Brières. I happened to contact some people there, and this man right here, his name is Christian Deville, contacted me back by email and said, I will see you at the town square at 9 o'clock on June the 1st. So we ended up going there and we made it finally. Went down to the town square, who wasn't too hard to find, and he met us there. From there, we got an agenda. He said, I would like to take you and show you all the different areas that we commemorate the 442nd. And so eventually he went around and he showed us that there was a street named for the 442nd Regiment. There were several plaques, and he took us to many of the battle sites. Then he indicated that, you know, after we've done this morning, and we had a great tour by him and a great explanation, he said, we must go for lunch. And I thought that we were probably going to go for a little fast food lunch somewhere, but they ended up taking us to a wonderful restaurant for a 6-course lunch. Now, what I learned was that Christian was an officer. This man, Michel, is the president of this group. It was called the Brières French Friendship Group, or the Go for Broke group. And they are a group that honors to this day, they probably have 80 to 100 members. They honor to this day the 442nd for liberating their city. After that, and I believe it was in the early 60s, because of this relationship, they actually were able to start a sister city relationship with Honolulu. And now many of them, every couple of years, go back and forth from Honolulu to Brières to have a sister city reunion. Anyhow, I'll turn it back to you now, Michael. I just wanted to indicate that people in France were very appreciative of what the 442nd did. And if anybody has an inkling to go there to visit, Christian would be a wonderful person to contact. Now, I think I'll turn it back to you. And if anybody has any questions, I'd be glad to answer whatever I can.
Sure, thank you. That's really interesting. You got a chance to visit over there. So we do have a question here from Kelly Russell. I think you mentioned you first heard of the 442nd because of the graves next to your grandfather. What about your uncles who served? Did you not hear stories, or did your family not talk about it? I'm just curious, was that something they wouldn't talk about while you were growing up, or? Did you hear stories?
Yeah. These stories, you know, my parents, when the war was over, my parents and my uncles and people of that generation, they just wanted to put all that period behind them. I mean, they've gone through a period of the Great Depression and a period of the war and many, many other things. It was the situation with the camps and incarceration and the war. We heard very little about that. So I didn't hear hardly anything about that from uncles, even my dad, who served and was actually in the occupation of Japan in Hiroshima. Very little about that. It wasn't probably until after or much later when they were getting into their 70s and 80s and 90s, and I was already, you know, way out of childhood. So it was not something that was really talked about. I probably learned more about the 442nd reading this book than I've ever known in my life. And the other thing about it, many of the other books about the 442nd kind of talk about the 442nd as a general group, a unit. I think what Mr. Brown has done to actually take four different people or three different people who are in it and speak about their own personal experiences, I think that is something that is much more unique and much more interesting. Yeah, we didn't know much about that.
That's interesting. That's I think I hear that often from people that they don't want to reflect on their experiences like that.
Oh, we had in Newburgh, we had, a neighbor and other people who were in horrendous things. Went onto the beach at D-Day, and the only thing you'd hear about is, I think they, mention it to my dad. My dad would just say, John Rack went on to Normandy. Mm-hmm. And that was it.
Yeah. Which brings me to another question here is about when the war was done and the people that were in the internment camps and returning back home, and what kind of experience did they have trying to get back home to where their houses were?
This is very interesting. They had varied experiences. One part that I couldn't really fit into this was that the Tokiwa's family, who were in camp in Poston, Arizona, they had the camp newspaper. And at the end of the war, they were getting reports back. They still could receive the newspaper from Salinas. And the newspaper had several reports and columns about not wanting I hate to use this word all the time, but not wanting the Japs back. And that's actually how they spoke, even in print during that time. And so it was very difficult when you saw this in your old hometown paper to actually try and, feel comfortable about going back home. Even in Gresham Troutdale, there was, there was this type of thing that was in the paper where they had notices of mass meetings by organizations that looked to be fairly reputable and trying to keep the Japanese from coming back. But you know what? These people didn't let that stop them. They came back. They settled back. And I remember one of my uncles said, all that happened, but we still had a lot of friends there too. Many families had people that, like the Tokiwas, that had neighbors that took care of their equipment. And my own grandparents, they had neighbors that looked after their farm. Many people didn't have that. Many people didn't have that. And they ended up going into the Midwest, into Chicago and Cleveland and Detroit and New York City. And of course, in Hawaii, they were not interned, so they were able to go back into their homes. But many different circumstances existed. Yeah, does that answer that to some degree?
Yeah, I think so. No other questions at the moment. Did you have anything else that you wanted to share about the book or
experience? I would say that I would say that, you know, what I said at the end is that it's not very often that a book like this comes out by an author like Daniel James Brown. A lot of times books like this will come out by the experience in camps or other experiences. And it's written by Japanese Americans in mostly and maybe some other, other people of interest. But I think what by having somebody like Daniel Brown, I like this picture here better. By having somebody like Daniel Brown do this, it offers a lot more credibility to the subject itself. Sometimes when you find that it's somebody who went through the experience, you know, maybe people kind of shut off their ears to that. But when somebody like Daniel Brown, who actually is looking at it from the outside, he didn't, his family and nobody else experienced it, then I think it offers a little more substance to the title. And when people see that all of a sudden he has written a book like Boys in the Boat, then I think they would be more apt to go, oh, they would like to read Facing the Mountain as well.
Thank you. We did have one more question come up about when families were returning from the internment camps, were they legally able to get back into their homes and property even if there was resistance? Were there laws put into place restricting them? Or I'm sure there were some local things, but...
Michael, when the internment camps ended, it's like all of a sudden they say, you're free to go. And like many people weren't ready for that. And many people were not ready to, didn't have places to return to. There were no laws that restricted, like my grandparents in Troutdale, they could go back to their place at, you know, at when they were allowed to. The only restriction would be, maybe financial restrictions, because by that time a lot of people really didn't have a lot of financial means, and that was another restriction. My grandparents, their farm was originally right next to what is now called McMiniman's Edgefield. Excuse me, I'm just trying to get this off of here. Anyway, it was right next to McMiniman's Edgefield, and my grandfather rented out part of the property to, it was before it was at McMiniman's, it was called the Multnomah County Farm. And he rented out part of the property to the Multnomah County Farm. When they came back, they weren't going to give it back. So they did have to go through a few legal means to do that. But no, there was no restriction. You could come back.
All right, thank you. All right. Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Russell. That was a really wonderful presentation. You added so much to that with your personal stories, and I really appreciate it. So. I think that will wrap us up for today. thank you to everyone for tuning in, and make sure you sign up for next month's.
Well, I'd like to thank you too. I'd like to thank everybody who's attended. I must say that it's a little bit weird for me to do this when I can't see everybody and get the feedback, but I think it turned out well just hearing the information. So thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you, everyone. Have a good day. Bye.